My name is John Michael, and I'll be presenting the cases to the board for their review during today's public hearings. At this time, we would ask you please silence your phones or other devices so that the board meeting will not be interrupted. The procedure for our meeting today will be to introduce the case record. We'll present site plans, photographs, aerial, zoning maps of the properties from today's cases. Additionally, the board members have received correspondence that's been submitted both in support of and in some instances in opposition to these cases, as well as correspondence from other government agencies. At the conclusion of the staff's presentation, the appellant will present his or her case to the board. After the appellant's presentation, the board will hear those wishing to speak in support of the appeal. In the event that the appeal has opposition, the board will then hear from those parties. After the opposition presents its testimony, the appellant will have a period of time for rebuttal if they choose to set aside such time. Under our BZA rules, the appellant has 10 minutes for presentation if there's no opposition present. In contested cases, however, BZA rules allow for 15 minutes for each side to present testimony as needed. Should the appellant wish to provide rebuttal testimony, the appellant shall reserve some portion of that originally allotted time. All section numbers that we refer to today come from the Metro Zoning Code. The zoning code was adopted by the Metro Council and became effective on January the 1st of 1998. The zoning code applies to the entire jurisdiction of the metropolitan government. I'll introduce the entire zoning code and make it part of today's record, thus dispensing with the reading of individual sections. The Metro Zoning Code requires a record of these proceedings. Because the BZA meetings are recorded for Metro Channel 3 and broadcast to YouTube, it's imperative that anyone addressing the board please come forward, speak into one of the microphones here at the front of the room. Speakers should identify themselves by name and address, and then make their desired presentations. At the conclusion of each case, the board will deliberate on that case and then vote. The board is vested with the power to take such action on these cases under the provisions of the Metro Zoning Code at Section 1740-180. The Metro Code requires four members of our seven-member board to establish quorum. The code also requires that at least four affirmative votes be passed in order to grant an appeal before the board. In the event that only four members are present, which is the case at this hour, and the appeal fails to receive four affirmative votes, the appeal will be re-advertised for the next available public hearing. In the event that five or more members are present and the appeal fails to receive the four affirmative votes, the case will remain on the board's agenda for the next 30 days. Applications that fail to receive four affirmative votes within that 30-day window shall be deemed denied by operation of law. Pursuant to board rules, an aggrieved party may request a rehearing within 60 days of the public hearing on the subject case. Additionally, aggrieved property owners may appeal board decisions to the Chancery Court within that same 60-day period. After that time elapses, the board's decision becomes final, and no further action can be taken. For the appellants, if your appeal is granted, you are required to obtain the permit for which you applied. A permit must be obtained within 2 years for a board's approval to remain valid. It should also be noted that if any false or misleading testimony is presented to the board, any board approval could be revoked at a later date by means of a show cause hearing before the Board of Zoning Appeals. Mr. Chairman, having reviewed the files, I submit that all cases have been filed in the proper order, all the appellants have been notified by certified mail, and all notice requirements have been fulfilled as required under the Metro Zoning Code. Before we begin our consideration of the consent agenda and any preliminary announcements, we typically take a moment to call for and recognize any elected officials who are in the audience, whether from the local, state, or other levels. I know I saw Councilmember Syracuse, Representative Gilmore. Pleasure to have both of you here. For any of those who might wish to speak among those groups on behalf of the case that they're here on today, Councilman Withers, sorry, I didn't see you there. Anyone who wishes to speak on behalf of one of the cases, you may do so at this time if you wish. You're welcome to wait. Councilman Pulley, pleasure to see you here as well, sir. I should take closer stock before I begin. Anyone is welcome to come and speak at this time among those elected officials if you wish to. Otherwise, you're welcome to wait until your case is called. We're quick to defer the microphone to anyone that might wish to speak at this time. Looks like a wait. Very well. Mr. Chairman, one preliminary announcement regarding our agenda today. Case number 2016-006 is a case that has been withdrawn and will not be heard by the board today. Additionally, the board has taken will take consideration of a proposed consent agenda. One board member in each case reviews the record for the cases prior to today's hearings. That board member identifies cases where the appellants have met the criteria for the requested action. If the reviewing board member determines that testimony in the case would not alter the material facts, then that case is recommended to the board for approval. We will enter into the record those cases that have been recommended, and if anyone is here in opposition to one of those cases, please raise your hand, and the case will be removed from the consent agenda and then heard in its regular order. The three cases that have been identified for the proposed consent agenda are case 2015-124 for Nicholas Corando, the appellant and owner of the property located at 817 Footpath Terrace. Is there anyone here in opposition to case number 2015-124? Seeing no one, that will be included in the consent agenda. The second case is case number 2016-002. Brenda Gilmore, the appellant, on behalf of Minerva Foundation, owner of the property located at 4022 Whites Creek Pike. Is there anyone here in opposition to case number 2016-002? Seeing none. The third and final item recommended for consent agenda is case number 2016-005 for Monaco Hoffman, appellant for the property at 2011 Hackberry Lane. Is there anyone here in opposition to case number 2016-005? Seeing no one, Mr. Chairman, those three cases, number 2015-124, 2016-002, and 2016-005, comprise the proposed consent agenda for the board's consideration today. This would be an appropriate time to consider a motion if there is one.
Can we have just a bit of conversation here? I think we have a question on one of the cases.
Sure.
I think it was the one, that was on consent because the garage was in a ditch and then there were stormwater concerns.
Excuse me.
As a matter of expediency, I think I'm going to go ahead and call for the vote on 2016-02 and 2016-05 on the consent agenda. There's a motion for, but I'm going to come back to it if I could. There's a motion for those two to be on consent. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Got a motion, got a second on 02 and 05. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, so those two pass.
And Mr. Chairman, if I may jump in there, for the appellants or any other interested parties who are here on case 2016-002, 2016-005, your appeals have been granted. You can pick up the permits tomorrow at the Codes Department, or as early as tomorrow at the Codes Department. Those cases will not have to have any further public hearing, and you're free to leave if you wish, free to stay if you wish. Sorry, back to you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and then in the intermittent while we study 124, I'm going to bring up case 123 and boldly speak for the council person. She just sent in the council person on case 123 sent in an email requesting that the case be deferred because she's homesick with her children and she'd like to speak prior to us considering it. I'm a little bit
Which one?
That's 123. It's the first one. And I will say I'm always in favor of granting council people the right to speak. This one's a little bit tough because we deferred it last time for that same reason. But unless there's a lot of opposition on the board, are we okay with deferring 23 at the request of the council person?
There's people here.
Can everybody who raised their hand for who's here on 123?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, the applicant, Mr. Cordova, it's my understanding, doesn't speak English very well.
Right.
So it's our pleasure to have Mr. Leoncio Dominguez with us here today. And he's with the Water Department. He's volunteered to translate for us today, should we need him.
Okay.
President, I think we should at least ask the applicant what is most convenient for them. Okay. So I guess I'm going to direct this to the translator. Can you please ask the applicant how a two-week deferral, and the council person is asked to be here to speak and can't be here to speak today, so we're talking about at least a two-week, maybe he wants a four-week, whatever is his choice. Is he accepting of a deferral?
So if I understand correctly, the council person has asked for a deferral of 2 weeks?
2 weeks.
The council person wants to speak?
Yes.
So if I'm going to ask the appellant if he would like to defer the meeting.
If he is willing to defer for 2 weeks, then we don't have to make a decision. But if he's not willing, then we have to make a decision. So anyway, I'm just trying to be as courteous as possible because he's now been made to come back twice.
Yes, sir. Luis Cordova. I guess he's walking over here. La pregunta es que la persona que es en el concilio, la persona del concilio está pidiendo escuchar tu caso en 2 semanas. Está pidiendo que lo defieran, que lo pospongan en 2 semanas. Y te está preguntando aquí la junta directiva si estás de acuerdo tú a esperarte otras 2 semanas. O puede ser 4 semanas, pero te están enfocando en 2 semanas. Si estás de acuerdo tú esperarte otras 2 semanas. He's asking if there's option.
I'm sorry. Even if we could get him to sit at the mic, I don't know how you do that.
Is this okay? So he asked if there was an option. I asked him if he was willing to wait those 2 weeks, and he's asking if there's an option.
There is an option. It's for him to present his case through you, and then we're going to have to balance the needs of the council person, so we'll hear the whole case. Yes, that's the option. If he wants to present his case, we'll have to hear it, and then we'll have to make a decision on whether we're going to grant the council person their request.
Yes. Sí, que sí tienes una opción. Mm-hmm. Que la opción es que tú presentes tu caso ahorita, si tú deseas que yo te ayude a traducir, y que la junta directiva tienen que balancear entre ellos cuatro y ellos van a tomar la decisión.
Y para presentar un caso, ¿qué es lo que tengo que hacer? O sea,
he's saying to present a case.
Solamente es lo mismo que escribí en la carta.
He's saying to present a case, what do I have to
es
do?
Es lo que estoy pidiendo.
Is it the same thing that I wrote in the letter? That's what I'm asking.
Yes, essentially. I mean, he needs to the office will present their case. He'll get an opportunity to speak. And were the council person here, they would oppose it. And then we're going to have to make a decision.
Que sí, que esencialmente sí, lo que dijiste de la carta, mm-hmm. ¿no? Entonces la oficina de códigos va a presentar su caso después tú y después ellos van a tomar una decisión.
Yo creo que sí querría hacerlo hoy porque ya tengo 3 meses con esto y
Permanentito. Yes, I do believe that I want to do it because I've been dealing with this for 3 months.
Mm-hmm. Y sí me gustaría terminar ya lo que pueda terminar hoy mismo.
And yes, I would like for to complete what I need to complete.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman, let me point out too that we only have 4 people here today. It takes 4 affirmative votes to pass something, and if it did not pass today, it would then come back for the next council meeting anyway and be heard by whatever we have present that day, correct? So he has essentially two shots at it, I would guess, if he hears it today. So.
Okay. I think that's pretty accurate. Okay, then we will hear his case, and just for a recap, we passed the consent agenda with respect to 02 and 05, and we withdrew 124 from the consent agenda. And so, John, why don't you take it before I blow it anymore?
Okay. With that, the cases we will hear today, it seems, will be case number 2015-123 for 1314 Kermit Drive, case number 2015-124 for 817 Footpath Terrace, case 2016-001 located at 2535 Lebanon Road, case number 2016-008, property at 209 South 5th Street. With that, we'll pull up the presentation for the first case, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, as reference, case number 123 is located in Council District 13, just off Briley Parkway, at 1314 Kermit Drive, as shown here in the aerial photograph. So the zoning map shows this is an RS10 zoning district. The development patterns relatively consistent in terms of street frontages, single-family dwellings, at least along this particular portion between Kirby and Kipling. The site plan that's been submitted demonstrates the footprint for a structure that has been torn down and now is subject to being built back as a single-family residence. The request before the board today is for a variance from the street setbacks in the RS10 district. After the zoning examiners measured the appropriate required setback based upon the contextual development of the neighborhood on this block face, the existing footprint at which the appellant wishes to build was not did not meet the required setback under that contextual measurement. So I think, let's see, we've got the particulars here. I think it was a reduction from 38 and a couple of inches to 30 and a few inches. So that's the variance request that's before you today. Certainly we can provide the brass tacks. I know that's in your packet, but we can give you the exact numbers if need be. The photographs of the subject property show that construction has been underway. The second photograph in the lower right-hand corner just shows you a view of the property across the street. Up and down Kermit Drive in these two photos. And because there was a stop work order posted, we thought it was important to point that out. The stop work order at some point had been removed in some apparent confusion with regard to what permits were required, but has since been reposted. Work has in fact stopped at that location until this matter is determined by the Board of Zoning Appeals as to whether or not the variance from the setback requirement will be approved. The appellant will have actually have 10 minutes to present his case today, as there is apparently no opposition present in the room today to speak on the matter. We would encourage our board members to remember, in the event that questions are asked of the appellant, please give our translator an ample opportunity to translate those questions for the best possible translation. With that, we'll turn it over to the appellant. Mr. Dominguez, if you're comfortable translating for him now, and let him tell the board what he wishes to tell them.
Adelante, puedes decir lo que tú quieras. So I'm just saying, go ahead, just speak. Adelante, puedes decir lo que tú quieras, señor Córdoba.
Pues la razón nomás por la que quiero hacer esta apelación.
The reason why I want to make this appeal.
Es porque, como pudieron ver allí, ya tengo la mitad del trabajo hecho.
Like you could see there, I have half of the work done.
Y me va a costar unos pocos miles de dólares tirar todo otra vez. Por no tener conocimiento de las leyes que están cambiando día con día, ¿verdad?
And it's going to cost me a few thousand dollars to turn down and rebuild for not knowing the changing codes, the new and changing codes.
Sí, porque sí, pues solamente por no tener conocimiento de eso y otra de las razones.
Mainly because of not being aware of that. And another of the reasons.
sería porque los planos que yo tengo para esta construcción me están pidiendo 6 pies más de lo que estaba anteriormente y estoy usando la fundación antigua.
And also because the drawings are requiring six feet
mm-hmm.
to the front, mm-hmm. and I'm also building on the same original foundation.
Yeah. Pues, es todo lo que necesito, 7 pies, 3 pulgadas y
that's all I need, 7 feet and 3 inches.
Tengo un máximo de 38 pies ahí, so pensé que podría apelar para pedir esos 7 pies.
And I have a maximum of 38 feet there, so I just thought I could appeal those additional seven feet.
Pues es todo, creo que
that is it. Mm-hmm.
Do we have any questions for the applicant?
Was the home vacant when he bought it? Was he living in the home before the reconstruction?
¿Estabas viviendo en esa casa antes de que la empezaste a construir?
No la compré. No. No la pregunté, no.
No. He was not living at the house. I think he's answering your second question. That's the question I translated. If he was living in that house before, and he said no.
Did he immediately purchase it and begin the renovation then?
Cuando la si inmediatamente la compraste y empezaste la renovación. Yes.
Was how long had the home been vacant when he purchased it?
¿Cuánto tiempo había estado vacante la casa antes de que la compraste?
Alrededor de 8 años y el fundamento estaba totalmente malo, es por eso que decidí tumbarlo.
Around 8 years and the foundation was really bad.
No, foundation cross base,
the cross base.
Sistema del, sí, sistema de piso.
The footing was really bad, so that's why I took it down. Mm-hmm.
Mr. Michael, can I see the picture of the building, the actual, with the framework? Thank you.
What is the bottom right corner? Is that across the street?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Are there any buildings behind this residence? Is there a garage or something back there?
¿Hay algún edificio atrás de la residencia, como un garage, como?
No, solamente yo hice una edición de 14 pies, lo extendí.
There isn't?
Extendí la vieja fundación 14 pies con un sistema nuevo de fundación.
Okay. There isn't? And I extended the original foundation 14 feet. I think it's meant to the rear, yes. Atrás. Mm-hmm. Yes, the rear.
Can you ask him if he understands that any other, if his variance is granted, that any other additional work making the house a greater size will require another permit?
Que si entiendes que si se te da, si se te otorga ahorita la apelación, que el hacer tu casa más grande va a requerir un permiso adicional.
Sí, de hecho para la edición que hice saqué permiso y mandé a hacer inspección del FURI nuevo. No sé si estoy hablando de otro permiso.
He says yes, and for the additional foundation to the rear, I got a permit for that. I'm not sure if you're asking for an additional permit of that.
I'm trying to make sure that he understands any other additional work is going to require another permit.
Que si entiendes que cualquier otro trabajo adicional va a requerir un permiso.
Sí.
Yes.
And the house that was torn down, will that be replaced in kind, meaning no second story and it'll look relatively the same?
Que si la casa que se que demoliste, que si se va, vaya, my English is limited, so when you say in kind, I'm just going to, I'm assuming that it means the same as it was, que si vas a poner la casa a igual como estaba antes, o que si vas a añadir un segundo piso.
Esa era la, bueno, mi idea era añadir segundo piso, mm-hmm. sí, porque no miré ningún owner association ahí que me lo impidiera. Okay. So, mi total de pies son a 3,800.
He says, yes, that was my initial plans, because I didn't see any homeowners association, so I saw that I was allowed to do that.
Mm-hmm. Y ya investigué los pies máximos que puedo tener y sé que puedo hacer hasta...
He had mentioned 2,000 square feet in the before he was saying, so he said, I have investigated, researched, and I am allowed to do that amount. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I have a question.
Yes, sir.
So did he get a demolition permit to tear down the existing house, and then did he get a permit to build back?
Una pregunta, que si sacaste un permiso para demoler la casa y después para regresar otra vez. I have a demolition permit.
Y ahorita no me pueden dar un permiso para nueva construcción hasta que no pase aquí. And es lo que me dijeron en los códigos.
And I am not allowed to get a new building permit until I don't go through the appeal process and I get the appeal from you.
So he applied for a permit to build a new house, which is what he's doing now.
¿Aplicaste para construir una nueva casa?
Nueva construcción en fundación existente.
A new building permit on the current original foundation.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. King, on behalf of staff, you hit it right on the head. The demolition permit was obtained, the demolition completed, and the building permit for this project is, just as the applicant precisely described, is hinging on this decision from the board.
Do we have any other questions? Okay, I'm going to move to close the public hearing and enter discussion. And I'll start. I am always deferential to council people. But this is a toughie because we've already deferred this guy once. And I'll be honest, I put this on the consent agenda because I think it'll ultimately pass. And everything the council person has raised has been about future acts, nothing that's in front of us today. I mean, the only thing in front of us today is when he built on the foundation, would we, as a remedy, make him tear down his siding? And the council person's objections so far have all been future plans. And that's why I asked my question about, does he know he needs another permit go forward? Because that seems like the proper place to discuss the council person's issues. So if one of us says let's defer because we'd like to hear from the council person, I'll be fine with that. But I do think I need to kind of voice that I think, well, at least this person put it on the consent agenda. Okay, then I'm going to make a motion that the board approve the variance because all of the requirements of MCL 17.40.370 have been met, and the board finds that the unique characteristics of the property are the pre-existing foundation of the building, and that's the extraordinary and exceptional condition of such property that would result in a peculiar and exceptional practical difficulty, namely pulling down his siding, and exceptional and undue hardship on the owner of the property. Is there a second?
I'll second.
So you have closed the public?
Yes, we have. We closed it. Okay, so we've got a motion. We've got a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes.
Mr. Dominguez, thank you very much for translating for us.
Mr. Chairman, your next case, 2015, number 124, is for the appellant Nicholas Corando, the appellant and owner of the subject property at 817 Footpath Terrace. The request is for a variance from the rear setback requirement and also a variance from the required square footage limitations for a detached garage in the rear of an existing single-family residence in the RS 15 district. The zoning map shown here points out that it is an RS 15. This is in the Metro Identified Floodplain Zoning Overlay District. Of course, that's not the official FEMA floodplain, as we always point out with these maps. Overhead here shows the development of the neighborhood, a traditional single-family neighborhood in the far southwestern corner of Davidson County. Site plan submitted gives an idea here just to the far left of this particular picture as the proposed construction of the garage in question. It would be one of multiple accessory structures on the premises behind the primary dwelling structure shown here further to the right and closer to Footpath Terrace. Photographs shown here, the larger gives you a straight on shot of the primary dwelling. The second shot there in the upper left-hand corner is the view directly across the street. The view up and down the street, Footpath Terrace. With that, we'll point out that the request in particular for the rear setback would reduce the property setback from the required 20 feet down to 10.9 feet, the reduction of 9.1. And secondly, with regard to the square footage, this was one that Council wisely raised the question before the meeting, and we pulled it up to be sure. The section of the Metro Code that's triggered here as far as accessory building floor area controls is 1712.050, subsection A, as noted there in the original appeal and in your docket as well. The governing section talks about the two criteria whereby we measure the maximum square footage for those kinds of structures. It's either a maximum of 700 square feet or half, 50%, no more than 50% of the building coverage of the principal dwelling, whichever is greater. In this case, the square footage of the primary structure is less than 1,100 square feet, so the 700-foot standard is what applies with the small gazebo, with the open carport, and with the proposed garage at the rear of the property. This is going to put the square footage total somewhere in the ballpark of 1,158. Taking off the 700 that's allowed under the zoning code, the square footage variance requested is for approximately 458 square feet. So you have the variance request for the setback and also for the square footage limitation. We always try to remind the board when there are basically two requests in front of you, it's possible that you could have different votes on the two items, the same on both items. Either way, if you think you need to split it, please do take two votes at the appropriate time. With that, the appellant will have the opportunity to present his case. I'll ask just to be clear, is there anyone present in the audience today in opposition to case number 2015-124? Please signify by raising your hand. Seeing none, the appellant will have the full time to present your case and field any questions from the board, and certainly staff will remain available to answer any questions should the event become necessary. Mr. Corando.
Thank you. I'm just asking for, as I said, amount of square footage to the allotted amount plus the setbacks. As seen in the picture and noted in the back there, the garage is towards the back left of the property. And I don't really have much else to say about it. Is there any questions?
Can you tell us about your hardship, why you're requesting these two variances?
I didn't exactly receive a formal list of hardships that might apply to my situation. My only hardship, I guess, is that I'm just kind of appealing to the hearts that the only other offer that our option that codes came up with was to enclose the carport, and it just prevents that, you know, I can see my family in the backyard from my house from the windows, and it's just not a safe feeling. There's little to no impact to the neighborhood as far as flood water, you know, any of that. I have to fill out a variance with stormwater and Ms. Policy, so this is just kind of a preliminary step in a, you know, a longer process.
Have you filled out the form, and has the Metro Stormwater Department reviewed the plans?
No. I've talked with Ms. Key and had some correspondence, but not officially turned in my my variance yet. This was kind of the two parts of getting this project done. It was a shorter, sweeter side of getting the project done, and a little bit less expensive to maybe see if I could get this appeal through and maybe skip some other things with the variance side.
Yeah. You might not be aware, but there was an opposition letter that noted concerns with stormwater. I guess one of your neighbors.
And somehow the codes department sent the letter out incorrectly the first time, and they changed it afterwards, resent the letter out. So I think that it might have been a little, you know, I don't think they had the full information the first time when they sent a, you know, a letter of opposition.
And on behalf of staff, Mr. Carondo said it just right. The first notice that went out only made reference to the setback request in order to build the garage, but didn't specify that there is also a variance requested for the square footage component. We didn't want something like that to trip him up in the event that there was opposition who chose to appeal on a very highly technical ground. So we corrected the notice by sending a fresh one out with the absolutely precise information in it so that Mr. Carondo would have a clean bite at the apple here at BCA.
Yep.
Did I understand you to say that you're going to go in front of the Stormwater Committee next?
Yes. Yes, sir.
That may...
I don't know. I just... Well, we have to deliberate when the public...
No. I hear you. Do we have any other questions for the applicant, or...?
I guess the concern was, that there was a swale perhaps made in several backyards, and that you were going to level part of the swale, and the swale wouldn't be effective. And this all deals with handling stormwater. And
Under the stormwater guidelines, you know, they really watch that pretty closely. I'm not able to bring in extra fill material to allow the water to shed off my property to somewhere else. They want you to use FEMA wet-proof, you know, building construction techniques to allow water to pass through the building. So it's just a garage to me. You know, I'm not looking to impact anybody else in the neighborhood, and I believe I've talked to everybody that's within, you know, sight of my house. So I believe outside of this one opposition that, you know, I think I'm in good shape.
Is part of the reason for the chosen location of the garage the fact that you have that slope in your yard?
It is flat in the back, you know, back left section of the yard. Yeah, it would just work out better with stormwater and to have a flat piece of land to build on. There'd be less removal and less fill, you know.
And the reason for the increase in size over the existing structure, is that necessary for what you're doing? Does that affect the setback that you're also requesting?
The existing structure was there when I bought the house, and it's just a small portable shed, so... It's not to replace that, or, you know, it's not really involved, I guess, as maybe as, you know, you're thinking.
Will anything be torn down, any of the accessory structures that might lessen the square footage you're asking for?
With your approval, I'd like to keep all my accessory structures up. There's a gazebo over the deck that's closer to the top of the page up there. Yep, and then the carport. You know, I'd like to keep everything in place just as I bought the house.
Mr. Chairman, just looking at the grading plan, it appears to me that there may be a justifiable hardship in that that lot does fall roughly 6 feet in the back back there, so I could support a justification for that myself.
Okay. Any other questions for the applicant, or Christine, do you have any, or you look okay? All right. Then, would you like to say anything else, or
no, sir?
Okay. Then I'm going to move to close the public hearing. Discussion.
I guess I'll say I think the Metro Stormwater Department needs to look at it only because the concerns that were brought up, and it is in the maybe not the FEMA floodplain, but I mean everyone remembers the 2010 flood, so. I think that's what raised the flag for me, was that someone brought that up. I guess I'm not seeing a hardship so much, but maybe, at least for the square footage, maybe for the setback variance. But those are my thoughts.
So it will go before stormwater?
Yes. And they make us look like kitty cats.
I could support. If he can get stormwater approval, I'd be for it myself.
I'm actually good with it as well, and I do think there is a topographical issue with his property. And I also, personally, I found it kind of compelling that he wants to be able to see his children out of the back window. I mean, that makes sense to me.
Okay, I could go along with that as long as Stormwater reviews it as they are going to, but also that they comment on the extra impervious square footage that he's asking for, because that all ties in together with Stormwater regulations.
I agree with that. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to make a motion that the board approve the variance request, both with respect to the rear setback and the square footage limitation, based upon the topographical issues and the safety issues involved. However, this approval will be subject to his gaining stormwater approval of the project and the amount of impervious surface in his project.
I'd second that.
Okay, got a motion, got a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes.
Well, Mr. Chairman, that'll bring us to our next case, 2016-001. Peter Curry, the representative, an appellant for Connolly Brown, owner of the property located at 2535 Lebanon Road. This case is an appeal of the zoning administrator's denial of a permit to operate Tennessee Quick Cash at this location in the CL zoning district, based on staff's interpretation of the land use table designation under MCL 17.08030. It's referred to the board specifically under section 17.16.050D1. Property shown here. Property shown here on the zoning map in the CL zoning district. The aerial gives a view of how the building is fixed just across the parking lot from a church and a smaller strip business development slightly up or down the street further. As you can see, it was previously a restaurant that properly placed zoning signs with the views back inbound on Lebanon Pike. And the upper left-hand corner of the view over toward the strip of businesses. Of some note, we will be getting into the code requirements with regard to placement of this business near this particular first cash business. And in the lower left-hand corner, a shot of the church and church parking lot across the street as well. Finally, the view outbound on Lebanon Pike and a somewhat more straight-on view of the building as it stands, I would say as of today, but at least as of this week. The
sections of the code that will be of interest to the board in this case are 1716-050-D1. For beginners, in the event that the board determines that the zoning administrator's interpretation was correct, that would be an upholding of his classification under the land use table of cash advance as the use for the proposed use for this property, as opposed to financial institution, which is the counterargument that will be brought forth capably by Mr. Curry in just a moment. In the event that the board agrees that cash advance is the appropriate land use designation under the land use table, then 1716-050-D1 creates a distance requirement between businesses that hold that land use designation. Because of the property shown, or the business shown across the street in the upper right-hand corner of this photo, we are less than the 1,320 feet, approximately quarter mile requirement between such businesses, and thus the permit would be denied. Mr. Curry will present the case on behalf of his clients, and then if there's any opposition present, they will have the opportunity to speak thereafter. Mr. Curry, as always, we remind folks, if you wish to set aside some time for rebuttal, please do so during this initial 15 minutes. Mr. Curry.
Yes, I'd like to reserve 5 minutes. Are you going to change that to 10, or let me know when I've got 5 left?
Good. I'll let you know.
All right. Members of the board, this case arises under an ordinance that was adopted back in 2014. And you'll hear a lot about that ordinance, and that ordinance was passed in an effort to preserve and protect neighborhoods from deterioration, and that my clients type business can have a detrimental effect on property values, that business being consumer loans.
Mr. Curry, can you bring your mic a little bit closer? I think people are having a hard time hearing you.
All right. I'm also a little dry in the throat here. But in this particular case, my client's been in this neighborhood for 12 years. I mean, this is not a new business coming in. My client's rented a store location about 1,500 feet down the street. And what they did, in reliance upon the zoning code, a fair reading of it, they purchased this property last year and then attempted to, they were going to renovate it and move their business there. And then lo and behold, at the last minute, they find out that the flex loans that they were going to offer the public aren't really flex zones in the view of the Metro Legal Department, but they're payday loans and therefore subject to this restriction. But I think it's quite clear that the fact that they've been in business in this neighborhood for 12 years, there is a need for these kind of financial services for people in that area. And it's proof positive that there's such a need. And the question is whether or not the council's attempt to limit these type businesses in certain areas applies in this case. We don't think it does. We think it was simply a case where a bunch of people got together and said, oh, listen, this guy's going to be making loans to poor people, working class people, not our kind of people, and we don't want that in our neighborhood. And they just seized upon a distorted interpretation of the zoning code to achieve that result. But let me move on. Before this ordinance was adopted, there was a use in the zoning code called financial institution. And it was a use within the office portion of the zoning code. So within office uses, you had financial institution. And it stated that any building, room, space, or portion thereof where an establishment provides a variety of financial services, including generally banks, credit unions, and mortgage companies. Well, in November of 2014, the council, in an effort to restrict consumer lending to certain segments of the population, changed the definition of financial institution. They left the definition exactly the same, but then they said, comma, excluding check advances, check cashing, and title loans. And then they defined, they adopted a new definition of check advance, check cashing, and title loans. And what they said, because they were in a bit of a bind, you see, banks make payday loans. They make title loans. They check cash checks every day here in Nashville. And of course, they couldn't very well try to limit that because the banks would never allow that to go through the council, number one. And number two, that really wasn't their intent. They didn't mind having a region's bank, the neighbors, or the opponents, having a region's bank do this. They just didn't want one of these smaller companies doing it and drawing in people they didn't want in their neighborhood, even though many of these customers live in that neighborhood. In any event, to get around it, what they did is they said, you are a check advance business under our zoning code if you're licensed under Chapter 17 of Title 45 of the Tennessee Code, which licenses check advances. In other words, you can't make a payday loan unless you're licensed by the state under Chapter 17. All right? Banks don't have to be licensed. Same thing with check cashing. They said you are a check casher if you are licensed under Chapter 18 of the state code, which licenses check cashers. And the same thing with title loans. Now, the issue of whether or not that's a denial of equal protection has yet to be looked at by the courts. In other words, when a bank charges $5 to cash a check, and someone over here in a small store charges $4 to cash the same check, is that a difference in use? Well, of course it's not. But we're not at that point yet. At some point in some other case, that might be an issue that will be resolved. Suffice it to say, the issue here is much simpler. So everything rocked along fine for a year until the state legislature, in its wisdom, adopted a new chapter 12, and that chapter is entitled Flexible Credit Act. And what it did is it then provided licensing for are for businesses which make flex loans. And the state act defines what flex loans are. It's a line of credit, that's all it is, pure and simple. Every one of you has a line of credit on your credit card, if you have a credit card. You have a line of credit, approved credit. That's a line of credit. Some of you have, Mr. Whitson, most likely, has a very fancy line of credit with one of the big banks here in town, under which he can draw down innumerable amounts of money up and down from time to time. That's all this is, but it's a line of credit for working people. It's a line of credit for people that don't have a $10,000 line of credit on their credit card. It's a line of credit for people who have filed bankruptcy and banks won't do business with them. Simply won't do it. And that's the kind of customer, portions of the kind of customers it was designed to serve. In any event, my client, he can read, he read the code before he bought this property, and he said, well, I'm not going to do payday loans. I'm going to do flex loans. And it's not subject to this limitation. Black and white, you can read it. There's no question. There's no interpretation to be done here. Why? So, unfortunately, he didn't ask the Metro Legal Department about how they interpreted this black and white letter law. So he bought the property and then went to pull a permit to renovate it. And at first, the reviewer, zoning review, didn't know what to do. I mean, he said, wait a minute, you're Tennessee Quick Cash. You've got a dozen stores here in Nashville, over a dozen stores here in Nashville. You do payday loans at these stores. Yeah, but we're not going to do payday loans here. We're going to do flex loans. Well, the plans reviewer doesn't know what a flex loan is. He's not expected to. So he basically said, look, I'm going to kick this upstairs. And he did. And then upstairs kicked it up to the Metro Legal Department. And then we got back to where we actually made the application because it had never been filed. expecting that it was going to be approved, and it was denied because the legal department found that making a flex loan is akin to doing a payday loan. Now, you only have to read the definitions here to answer this question. Now, under Chapter 17, the State Act describes payday loans, cash advances, as a transaction pursuant to a written agreement involving the following combination of activities in exchange for a fee. A, accepting a check. B, holding that check for a period of time prior to presentment. And that's what a payday loan is. There's only one way you can do a payday loan, and that is you write them out a check, or an ACH form, but a check dated today, give it to them.
You're approaching 5 minutes.
All right, well, I'm going to get into it. So. Okay. And then 2 weeks later, they come in and they pay you the money and they get their check back. Real simple. All right. Now, the new flex loan, listen to the definition of a flex loan. A flex loan means a loan, a written agreement between a licensee and a customer, establishing an open-end credit plan under which the licensee contemplates repeated non-commercial loans. No mention of a check, no mention of a time period, predetermined period. An open-ended credit plan. All right. Now, you know, the board, the function of the board is, I think, primarily in two areas. One is to grant relief to property owners, such as the two people that were here earlier, that for various reasons seek a variance to avoid hardship. And the other role for the board, I think, is to protect property owners, both sides of the fence. Protect property owners. And that's what we have here, I believe. We have an erroneous finding by the zoning administrator. My client is irreparably damaged. He's bought the property. Not on a whim, not on some bad advice. All he had to do was read the code. The 13-20-foot limitation didn't apply to him, and it doesn't apply to him. Please, just look at those two definitions and come to your own determination. Is my client making payday loans when he does a flex loan? No. What he is classified as is a financial institution because he's providing a variety of financial services. Flex loans, bill pays, Western Unions, money orders. All of those are financial services that my client will be providing, but not payday loans. And I think that's evidenced by the fact that the council recently, there's been a bill introduced to add flex loans to these distance requirements because they know it's not covered now. So we would ask you to exercise your prerogative and correct this erroneous finding and not have the burden placed upon my client, a local businessman, to suffer this loss. Thank you.
Thank you.
I believe I have 2.5 minutes. Thank you.
I had a question.
Certainly.
does your client provide any other services other than flex loans?
Well, as I mentioned, he will be doing bill pays. You can come in and pay your bills. You can money orders, obtain money orders. I'm not sure if he's doing Western Union at this location or not. You can buy stamps, you can, but the answer is no, he's going to do flex loans. He's not going to do payday loans, and he's not going to do title loans.
So no cash advance?
No cash advance. Those are payday loans. Vernacular payday loans, zoning code, cash advance. The state calls them deferred presentment loans, but they're all the same, known as payday loans.
Mr. Curry, what is the collateral for the loan? I mean, what is
the state? The State Act allows for, doesn't require any collateral. And in some cases, these will just be signature loans. I mean, you must understand, these are people who cannot get credit services from banks.
No. I get all of it. I'm thinking there's got to be some form of collateral.
You can take a deed of trust on their house if you like.
Right.
You could take a lien on their title on their automobile.
But I guess I'm asking, and you don't need to answer this now because you might need to ask your client, but can you ask your client what is going to be his standard collateral?
I can answer that question. There will be no standard collateral. Okay. It'll depend on the customer. I mean, there are customers who will come in and use services like this three or four times a year. Christmas time, right before tax refund time, and they're known customers, and collateral would be known, just their signature. It's always been good. A new customer, they might say, they might want to take a lien on his automobile if it's a $2,000-$3,000 line of credit. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. We'll hear from the opposition. Or is there opposition?
There is.
Oh, okay. Whoa, okay.
And Mr. Chairman, with the council member being present, we would typically invite him to speak first if he should wish.
No, I agree with that.
I will ask for the last.
Okay.
The former council member, Phil Claiborne, I believe will go first, and then we'll have other constituents.
Great. If you could just make sure you divide your time so that you end up in about the 15-minute mark.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, members of the board. I'm Phil Claiborne. I live at 2911 Western Hills Drive. I'm here today as a resident of the Donaldson area, but also as the former council member of this area. I'm here as one of the supporters of the BL 2014-908, which was referenced. We passed that during my second term in the council in November of 2014, and the ordinance set distance boundaries that are central to this proceeding today. One of the first major actions that I took my first term in the council was to lead the community through a 14-month process, 2008-2009, that resulted in the passage of the Lebanon Road Urban Design Overlay. The purpose of that was to establish guidelines for the redevelopment of the business corridor that was in a state of decline. Since that time, several millions of dollars have literally been invested in this two-mile corridor, and I'm happy to say that this decline is being reversed. We're moving in a positive direction. At the time of the passage of 2014-908, other business corridors in the city were struggling with similar issues, the proliferation of these payday loan sites. They were threatening progress that they were trying to make, and so the attempt to deal with those threats was the distance requirement that was established in an effort to prevent the clustering of these businesses close together. And the authority for the ordinance at the time, through the Metro Legal Attorney as well as the Metro Legal Department, was based on a Supreme Court decision, Village of Euclid, Ohio versus Amber Realty Company, which established the general principle that a municipality could exercise zoning restrictions that were designed to protect against uses that were deemed harmful to a community. And specifically, that could it be obtained through exclusion of businesses, separation of businesses, or the limitation of those businesses. So multiple studies have been done to point out the fact that the concentration of these financial service businesses have a detrimental effect on local property values and also on economic redevelopment. So the property in question now is across the road, as you saw, from an existing payday loan business. It's probably the oldest one in the Donaldson area. And it's in the center of a one-mile strip that contains seven of these particular kinds of businesses, five banks and two credit unions. So we don't have a money drought in Donaldson. It's easy to get money from whatever source that you need to go to get it. So in closing my remarks, I'd just like to refer to an old saying. You know, there's a saying that you can call a duck by any name that you want to, but if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it's a duck. Tennessee Quick Cash operates like an alternative financial service business. It looks like an alternative financial service business. Tennessee Quick Cash is an alternative financial service duck, and I'm strongly urging you to deny their appeal, to uphold the zoning administrator's decision, and show your support for the positive redevelopment of the Lebanon Road Business Corridor. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Don Lounsbury. Thank you for having me. I have a business at 2600 Lebanon Road, very close to this proposed location. 10 years ago, I bought a commercial building and had it built at great personal sacrifice. I had to mortgage everything I had and get a note from the landowner in order to build it. I've paid on it for 10 years now, and it's my sole means of retirement. How this neighborhood goes will determine what kind of a retirement I have. My immediate business neighbor to my left is a Title Max. My immediate business neighbor to the right is the First Tennessee Cash that has been referenced. So now this business will be almost across the street from my building. I'll be completely surrounded. Mr. Claiborne said that this was a duck, and I would like to submit that it's actually a turkey. And let me tell you why. In World War II, meat was rationed. My grandfather was a farmer. He had turkeys, and the government wouldn't allow him to sell them. He put a bow around their necks and sold them as pets. In a short period of time, the federal government found out and came down very hard on him. And I would like to submit that a payday loan business is a turkey, and a flex loan business is a turkey with a bow on its neck. Thank you.
I'm sorry. Actually, applause. No need. I mean, we don't need the applause.
My name is Ray Mosley, and I live at 151 Spring Valley Road in Donaldson. I'm the president, of the Bluefield Homeowners Association. We are opposed to this this move here, and for all the reasons that Mr. Claiborne said, and the neighbor over here. We have lived in Donaldson since 1980, and we've watched it go through the decline, and we've also watched it come back through its revitalization. We don't want to lose that, and we feel like that these payday loan places are they prey on the people that can least afford them, and we don't want to see any more of them in our neighborhood. Thank you.
Afternoon. I'm Willie McDonald, William E. McDonald at 207 Cumberland Trace there in Donaldson. I've been a resident of Donaldson and a banker since 1955. I'm very familiar with Lebanon Road Corridor. At the present time, an awful lot has been done to improve it, to make it look very attractive, and hoping we're going to be able to get a lot of more businesses there in our neighborhood. And I, along with a number of other business people, felt like that this is a mistake for this to be approved, and ask you that you would not approve it.
Good afternoon. I'm Mark Pugh. I live at 2721 Windermere Drive in Donaldson. Have been in the Donaldson Hermitage community for 30 years and have, like the gentleman said before, have watched the decline and now watching the uptick and enjoying it. I want to be brief, leave my time for Councilman Syracuse, but I do feel like this is something that will be detrimental to our community and have a very negative impact on the community. And I ask you to deny it. Thank you.
My name is Gabriel Hernandez, and I'm both a resident and business owner in Donaldson. The current location of my business is right off of Elm Hill Pike. I'm considering a major investment that will be right very near that Lebanon corridor. Looking at two locations, one right off of Lebanon and Pike and McGavick, and then another one that just became available that's just a few lots east of that location. Your decision and whether that business goes there or not will greatly affect my decision on where I will move my business. I feel that they are a detriment to the property values, and I also feel very strongly, just as Mr. Claiborne pointed out, there are already I think seven all together within a mile in that corridor. There is no need for another one, and I think the what they're doing is, in my opinion, playing with words and definitions of what's what and what's this, but it's very clear to me and I think many other people the type of business that it is and the type of people that will be attracted to that business. And again, I just want to, that whatever is decided will have an impact on where I decide to move my business. And so that's, thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Sierra Barnett, and I live on Elm Hill Pike in the Donaldson area. I have lived in this area for 3 years. My husband and I moved here as small business owners. We decided to start a business, bring our business from Texas here. And I have to say that we did not run to a payday establishment, a flex loan establishment, because a bank will, in fact, give you money to grow your business, even if you're making very minimal income. And I'm a testament to that. So there are options in a typical establishment, banking establishment. And as everyone has said here today, there are seven options for this so-called low income banking opportunity, which traditional banks do have options for. As everyone also is saying, it is essentially repackaging what is already out there and calling it something that it is not. As a resident of the area, I do urge all of you to consider not granting another business of this type to come into our area, because it not only is terrible for the beautification that Donaldson has worked so hard to create, the reputation that we're trying to build. And ultimately, the owner of this property has the opportunity to sell and still be in a net positive position, whereas if he stays here, the impact will be detrimental to our community. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for your service. I'm Jeff Syracuse. I'm the councilman in the 15th district where this business is. And I'd like to thank all my constituents, the neighbors, and business owners who are here, former Councilman Claiborne, and the other council members who are here in support of denying this appeal. When I moved to Donaldson in 2002, we were a community in transition, as you have heard, and we were going through some challenges. Our business community was not as vibrant and diverse as it once was. Our infrastructure was aging. Our high school was in the news for all the wrong reasons, and because of these things, our neighborhoods were starting to suffer. But this community rebounded because of the dedication and hard work of our neighbors, our business owners, and community's political leaders. McGavick High School was visited by President Obama as a showcase to the nation of how you turn a school around. Today, reinvestment in Donaldson's Central Business District has begun with new infrastructure and sidewalks on the way. Many new families are moving here with a strong and a hopeful community spirit like never before. I believe it will be considered one of the great economic revitalization stories in our history. Donaldson is a critical piece to Nashville's future, as it will be the first truly transit-oriented development with the Music City Stars, Donelson Station, via the leadership of Councilman Claiborne in passing the downtown Donelson urban design overlay. And it is shaping in a very exciting future for our community. The research studies about the alternative financial services businesses is profound. There are so many of them. You've heard some of them here today. Councilman Claiborne referenced the U.S. Supreme Court decision. Donelson, as you've heard, is one of those communities across Davidson County that has a high concentration of these businesses. The intent and integrity of BL 2014-908, which implemented those distance requirements, was a tool to help our communities continue positive economic redevelopment. This challenge to that ordinance should be denied. They are fundamentally the same business, no matter what iteration of alternative financial services business they want to call themselves. The name on the building would be exactly the same. The branding of the business is exactly the same. Mr. Curry mentioned that there is a need in this community for that. That is difficult to say that there is a need for people to be stuck in cycles of debt. They prey on people who don't know any better. He mentioned about collateral. If a collateral is a title to a car or your home, is that not really the same thing? The hardship is on them. Who is the hardship on? The hardship is on the community, as you've heard today, about the positive economic development things that are going on in this community. So the burden is not on them. They are flush with cash. The burden is on this community to try to keep moving us forward. You know, open-ended credit? How do you substantiate that? So you've heard all sorts of things today. I'll give you one more piece of legislation that was passed as a way of showing that this business model is not good for communities. Fiscal year 2007, Military Authorization Act, sponsored by the late Republican Senator from Virginia, John Warner, made it illegal for creditors to grant payday loans and car title loans to military members. Those businesses were in operation just outside every U.S. military base in the United States. Lawmakers passed the Military Lending Act after the Pentagon reported that predatory practices weaken the military and that the debt issues threaten the security clearances of military personnel. If that's the case for our men and women in uniform, it's also the case for our men and women in uniforms of our firefighters, our police, our teachers, and really the entire community. So I ask you, please, to deny this, and please help us continue our positive momentum at Donelson. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other opposition?
Yeah. Hi, Pete Horton from Woodland Waverly Historic Neighborhood. We're concerned about the historic Franklin Pike, so Nashville's Civil War route. 20 years ago, there were something like 20 pleasure palaces along the way. Mayor Purcell and the Codes Department got rid of them. And now we don't want these things over there. We've got three loan shark places there. We don't want any more. We don't want any more LED signs. We're going to try to bring back some of Nashville's boulevards. So we're certainly in lockstep with Donelson Pike people. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Curry, would you like to come back up?
Well, members of the board, it's almost like I'm up here on a different case. Everything I've heard so far has to do with the fact that payday lenders prey upon the weak and the economically disadvantaged. Now, that's arguable. You tell a working mother with two children, when her rent's due on Friday, and she's already a month late, and the landlord says, I want it by Friday or you're out of here. You tell her to go down to the local friendly bank and say, you know, I need to borrow $200. They'll laugh at her. They will absolutely laugh at her. Banks don't make consumer loans like that anymore. They'll tell you that. All right. The only place you can get it is to come to an alternative lender. Now, you would be amazed at the type of customers my clients have. A lot of Metro employees, a lot of state employees. And these are people, unfortunately, married, maybe with kids, don't make as much money as you do, they can't tap into their credit card or their checking account and get a quick $200 or $300 to cover something. All right? They don't have relatives they can go to and say, hey, Mom, hey, Dad, I need $200 until the first of the month. They don't have that. That's why they go to alternative lenders, because they have to. That's why the default rate is over 20%. So for every 10 loans an alternative lender puts out there, two of them aren't repaid. And on a payday loan, you can't sue them, because the state law doesn't allow you to collect attorney's fees or any of those things. So they just don't pay it. And that's factored into these exorbitant interest rates. But again, that's not the issue. We're not here seeking a variance on the distance requirements for a payday lender. We're not here today for that. We are here for the board to correct an erroneous finding under the zoning code. And as much as they like to say it's a turkey with a bow or a turkey without, a flex loan is not a payday loan. And therefore, this code section doesn't apply the restriction. It's black and white. Read it yourself. Right? And I would ask you to wait for another case to vent your spleen about high-priced payday loans. This is not that case. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the public hearing's closed. I'm sorry.
Yes.
You said early on that there was a need for the business that you're proposing here.
Yes, sir.
Does that exist in Donaldson now?
It does now, by virtue of the fact that my client's been there offering financial services for over 12 years to the to those kind of customers, the ones that need consumer credit.
He's not talking about your client. I'm talking about, does that service exist in Donaldson right now?
I believe there's a number of payday lenders in Donaldson. Yes, sir. I heard the
number. So you're not offering anything that's not already existing. Am I right or wrong?
I don't believe that there is a flex loan licensee in Donaldson. It's certainly not in this neighborhood, no.
Well, let me rephrase my question.
Yes, sir.
Can somebody come to an existing business there that's there now and operating and get the same service that you're offering?
Yeah, if your question is, could someone at one of these existing locations pull a flex loan license, the answer would be yes, barring some other reason that they couldn't do it, yes. But nobody has done that. Flex loans are relatively new. They just started, I think.
I don't believe you heard my question. I'm asking you, can the participant residents in Donaldson go into an existing business in Donaldson right now and get the same service that you're proposing to offer, that you're saying that?
A flex loan? No, sir, they can't.
I didn't say that.
A loan. The same service. I don't know what service you're talking about. A payday loan?
Whatever.
Well, yeah, they can go get a payday loan. Western Union, all those financial services I mentioned are available right now with existing stores, except for the flex loan.
No further questions.
Something related, I think. I thought you said your client had been in business in Donaldson already for 12 years.
Yes.
So were they offering another type of service?
Yes, they were offering title loans, payday loans, and check cashing about 1,500 feet down the street.
So on the same road.
Yeah, and they're still there. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're going to close that store and they were going to close that store and move into the one that they purchased.
So if the appeal is denied, will they stay in that same location and offer the flex loans?
Yes.
Yes. Excuse me. Didn't know the answer to that one. Answer is yes.
Any other questions from the board? Thank you, Mr. Curry. Close the public hearing. Discussion.
I don't have a lot of discussion, except that I believe that our Mr. Department over there was correct in their assessment of what this is, and it's So I'm willing to pass a motion, offer a motion that we uphold the decision of the zoning administrator's office and deny the request.
I have a question. I just want to make sure I understand that this is a matter that Metro Legal has rendered an opinion on. But what was the exact opinion? What equals what?
Let me share with you that you have a motion on the floor, so let's get a second of the motion so we can get to discussion, and I'll address that question.
I'll second it for purposes of discussion.
Okay.
Thanks.
Typically, when we have a situation where we have attorneys that are assigned to represent the board or advise the board, we have other attorneys render advice. So normally, that would be the case. And that attorney was not able to actually render the advice in this particular instance, is not present here today, was not able to be here today. We weren't able to make that arrangement. We did make that arrangement, as you may recall, when a similar case dealing with check cashing and cash advances was before the board. And in that case, I advised the codes department, and that other attorney came and represented the board. So let me say that first as kind of a caveat to frame what I'm going to say next. I have communicated at this point with the attorney that did render the advice, and I do not disagree with that advice. What that advice was, as I understand it, and Mr. Herbert will probably be able to add to that as he was the person that was in direct communication with my colleague, was that the zoning administrator has authority to classify uses, and the use as it is, as he understood it, most closely resembled that of a check cashing or cash advance type situation. And so he made a decision consistent with his authority under the code to classify uses. And the legal department was in support of that finding. So I'll yield to Bill in case he has anything else to add, but that's my understanding of the advice that was rendered.
As Mr. Curry says, the flex loan is a new land use. We don't have a land use classification for flex loan. So the zoning code under 17.08.030C says this regarding new uses. The zoning administrator is empowered to categorize new land uses not enumerated in this title according to the most comparable land use classification established by this title. The zoning administrator's decision may be appealed to the Board of Zoning Appeals. So I had that in the back of my mind. So I'm looking for what is the most comparable land use classification that we do have, because we don't have one currently for flex loan. Now, Councilman Syracuse has introduced a bill in council that will create that classification. But as of now, it's not pending legislation. We don't have it. So I then looked a little bit further, and under 17.04.050, regarding how you construe language, it says, all provision terms, phrases, and expressions contained in the zoning code shall be construed in order that the true intent and meaning of the Metropolitan Council may be fully carried out. So, I'm really left with, is this a financial institution? Is this a cash advance? Is it a check cashing? We have that land use classification. Or is it a title loan? We have that land use classification. Well, I threw out title loan just because it's not that. I threw out check cashing because it's not that either. So I'm really left with, is it a financial institution or is it a cash advance? So I looked at financial institution, and it says financial institution means any building, room, space, or portion thereof where an establishment provides a variety of financial services, including generally banks, credit unions, and mortgage companies, but excluding cash advance, check cashing, and title loan establishments. So historically, we've applied financial institution, that land use classification, to your traditional bank and your traditional credit union or mortgage company. I then turned and looked at the definition of cash advance. Cash advance means any building, room, space, or portion thereof where unsecured short-term cash advances are provided, including those made against future paychecks as regulated under Title 45, Chapter 17 of Tennessee Code Annotated. And to me, that word including actually carried a whole lot of meaning there, because it's not exclusive. In other words, it's not a cash advance is not exclusively a land use that is it's a business that that lends against future paychecks as regulated under that state law. So going back to the definition of cash advance, I was left with, is it it's a situation where unsecured short-term cash advances are provided. So to me, in weighing all of this out, I was left between, do I classify it as a financial institution, a traditional bank, or cash advance? In weighing it all that out, I landed on the definition of cash advance. And I got there simply because I thought it was the most comparable land use classification as I'm empowered to make that classification under the zoning code. And also, I felt like it was most reflective of the true intent and meaning of what the council had. So trying to carry out the council's full intent. That's how I landed where I did.
Thank you so much, Mr. Harbert.
I agree. Thank you so much. I'm glad to know every bit of that, because that's an incredibly thoughtful analysis, because to be honest, I thought Mr. Curry made a pretty compelling argument. You know, I mean, a flex loan sounds like a line of credit, which every bank in America offers. And I thought it was compelling, though I completely understand not wanting the check cashing in your community. And this is a fraud issue, and my motion originally was going to be, why don't we defer until there's seven of us so four of us aren't making it? But that's an incredibly thoughtful analysis, and it's hard, at least for me, to say it was either arbitrary, certainly not, or even an error. I mean, so...
Well, when I first talked with Mr. Curry about it, when he showed it to me, and he was very forthright and could not have been just better to work with on this, on all accounts, as Mr. Curry always is. And when I first looked at it, my first impression was, well, he's right. He's absolutely right. And then I conferred with the legal department, and then I took two steps back and went through the analysis that I just gave you, and that's where I ended up.
And let me make sure I understand one final thing. The flex loan is a use that is only prohibited in this instance because of the proximity to a similar institution, correct?
We do not have a land use classification for flex loan now. So I'm having to categorize it as something we do have. And the closest categorization that I could come to was cash advance.
And the reason that it's prohibited is because of proximity to another location.
That is correct.
Thank you.
Yeah. I'm thinking or wondering if I need to rephrase my motion, because all you've really done is justify my motion, so I'm going to leave it as is. That I deny, I move that we deny the appellant based on, I do not believe that the administrator erred in his decision.
Christine, would you like to speak? Or? Okay, then we've got a motion, we've got a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes.
We'll take a short comfort break before the next and final case. That case is for Ed Clay, the appellant, Joe Swanson, the trustee and owner of the property located at 209 South 5th Street over in the 6th District in East Nashville. They're requesting a special exception in the R8 zoning district to use the existing residence and property for historic home events. Of note, the property is presently permitted for such historic home events. The appellant points to jurisdiction under item C for special exceptions. We'll be reviewing portions of 17, 16, 160B with regard to the requirements for historic home events. The map that I'm placed before you now is the basic zoning map showing where we cut down Fotheland there near the intersection with 5th.
The aerial view gives you a good idea of the location of the property, the space that it takes, the historic structure there located facing the street near the bottom of this photo. And then the photographs of the property here from ground level, reminding you of the intersection there at South 5th and Fatherland being the location, the alley behind the property, going back in toward the, that's actually back toward downtown from that angle, I believe. And then the back corner of the property as well, shooting back in toward their wall, the appropriately placed signs for today's zoning appeal hearing. And with that, the appellant is represented today. Mr. White and Mr. Dean, I believe, are representing the appellant. They'll have their time to present their case. Obviously, Mr. White, you'll want to reserve whatever time you wish for a rebuttal. Opponents will have the opportunity to speak after those supporters of this case have had their chance to speak to the board. I believe there is at least one primary representative for opponent or opponents, and I know our district council member, Mr. Withers, is also present today on the matter. With that, we'll turn the matter over to the appellants for their presentation.
Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, my name is Tom White, offices at 315 Dedrick Street, along with my law partner, George Dean, represent the applicant in this case, much as we did in December of 2013, when this board unanimously approved 5-0 the special exception for this use. Back in December of 2013, we did as this board always requests us to do, and that is there was legal counsel here for some of the neighbors that had some concerns. We were at the front of the docket. We elected to go to the heel of the docket, and we spent 2 to 3 hours in a room next door walking through a number of conditions. They weren't general. They were very specific. We wrote them all down. We were very careful to be concise, at which point we thought we were able to come back in front of the board and give a total resolution as to these items. As we got ready to do that, it was brought to our attention that one particular individual had a problem with amplified music, which we thought was clearly already understood. And frankly, we felt a little bit sandbagged at the time because we had come in asking for a 5-year proposal. We'd been out here for 2 or 3 hours iterating a whole bunch of different things. Went with a 26-month proposal, which is what we agreed to. Talked about limiting the events far lesser than what we agreed to. But in light of what had happened, we came into this room. We read from the very sheet that I'm referencing to you every single item that was agreed to. Now, the board order at that time has been given to you. It's very clear that with legal counsel present, the opposition agreed to every single thing, the general conditions, the special conditions, other than as mentioned in the special conditions. That basically, special conditions accepting 15 and 16 have been agreed to by the applicant and their attorney, Jamie Holland. That's the reference that took place. Now, in front of you is a little map that shows where the amplified music was to take place and not take place. And what's important is if you look at that map, I put directions east, west, south on the map. The music was required to be directed to Fatherland and then to the south on South 5th Street. In addition, there was a requirement that there was allowed amplified music in the back of the property only for weddings and for a 1-hour period of time. Those were the specific conditions, and the board heard our discussion about that, and then the board, in addition to all the general and specific conditions that had been agreed to, made the findings on those two specific items. So there would be no confusion about it. That was my wonderful artwork that drew out the two areas that were in question, which we then turned into the board, so there would be no confusion with respect to the order, and there was not. Now, with respect to those specific issues, and since that time has taken place, the following are the facts. I verified today with the Metro Codes Enforcement Property Standards Division. They checked through their Kiva system. There's not been one complaint in the last 25 months over noise on this specific facility. In fact, no complaint about anything with that board. I've checked with the zoning administrator, Mr. Herbert, and as recently as yesterday or today, have had that same affirmation. There's been no complaint. Now, with respect to what took place at the site, we submitted our traffic and parking plan to the Metro Public Works Department. They thoroughly looked at it. They approved our plan at the time. The plan has worked exemplary. There's a limitation to what can be done on-street parking. When it gets to be more than 50 persons at an event, there's required valet. We've done that religiously since we had the approval here. We haven't had any issues with that at all. Now, In reliance on this approval, my clients here, Ed Clay is the representative, he'll cover this. My clients have spent more than $500,000 fixing up this piece of property. It's a magnificent piece of property. It's a showplace. You've got some brochures in front of you that basically show what it looks like, what an incredible asset it's been to Nashville. In addition, they've made charitable contributions to the school in the area. They've discovered and made incredible inroads in neighborhood relationships, all of which Mr. Clay can talk about. Now, required by the zoning ordinance is you're supposed to have a special hearing before you come back here. We did that. And on January 11 at 5:30, we had a meeting at East Ivy. Notices went out to all the property owners required. Seven people came to the meeting. That doesn't include the councilman, who's been very courteous and was present there, me and my clients. But there were seven people that came up. The same gentleman who objected to the noise 25 months ago was the person articulating a problem with the noise at the time. In trying to reach some resolution even on that issue, we were very clear that we would have a decibel reader at the property, and if someone would call Mr. Ed Clay, who's given his cell number out to everybody, they could immediately check the decibel reading at the property owner's closest line of complaining. That made good sense. That was received well by everybody except for this individual, and we left it on a basis that we would try to strike an agreement again. We were thinking about coming back in front of the board and saying we would like to have more events, we'd like to have more people. We said if we can reach this agreement, there's no point. It's been a great neighborly relationship. Let's leave it like it is. And we, of course, asking for a five-year proposal today, as we did when we were down here 24 months ago. We never received any constructive comment back about anything that might be able to done to placate this individual. But in the meantime, the head of the Historic Edgefield Board has written us and the council person and said they support the proposal. They support the 5 years if it's basically the same issues which we agreed to 2 years ago. They did have a condition. They did say basically they liked what we had proposed, and that is that there should be someone at the property who can check on the noise readings, et cetera, and have them visible at the time. Because the one person who had objected said that he had called the police on occasion. According to him, he did it four times in a little over 2 years. My client checked. There was one verification with the police. They came out there and found no violation. We haven't found anything else. We know about that one. But in order to simplify it, we said we would basically make a proposal. And the proposal which we're suggesting as a condition today is basically that at every event, Ed Clay shall have a decibel reader, and that person who's complaining can call Ed Clay. He gives his cell number out. We'll give it to the board, 856-1534. The individual complaining can meet Mr. Clay, go to the property line of the complaining person, do a decibel reading. Our proposal, if it's higher than 70 decibels, it's a violation. If it's not, it's just basically an outside event, period. Now, I also want to comment that Metro recently did a resolution where they had some problems with Ascend downtown, the new theater, which faces the river. And what they did in that case, and it was announced by Tommy Lynch, the head of Parks, was that they were allowed a decibel reading of 98%, 98, at the property line. We're talking about 70% at the property line of the closest complaining neighbor. We think that is a realistic condition, et cetera. Now, with respect to letters of support, I want to be very clear and say we've got a number of letters of support which we wish to turn in here. We had really hoped to come down here and everything totally resolved this time, but we can't make at least a few folks happy. But I do want to comment that among the letters of support, if you'll notice the conditions of approval here, the amplified music had to be directed to the south and to the west. Now, there's nobody across the street on the west side. That's where, in part, the fire marshal used to be, et cetera. But directly across the south is a housing project, which you can see on the map up here. And this is a letter from a lady that came down here and testified. We have no relationship with her other than she is a neighbor that we have had a decent relationship with. But her name is Geraldine Walton. She came down here 2 years ago. I live at 512 Fathland Street. Sorry I'm unavailable to be present today, but my grandchild and
great-grandchildren are out of school due to closings affected by the weather. Otherwise, I'd be present. I think that the complaint made against East Ivy Mansion is absurd, and I want the board to realize that noise is not an issue with this venue. They've done such a great job limiting the sound from the property. The Titans games are the real sound issues. That's far louder than East Ivy has ever been, and I'm the closest neighbor to East Ivy. Traffic is never a problem from the venue either. The only traffic problem comes from the Titans also. We live in senior homes, and my neighbors and me really enjoy having these events in our neighborhood. We'd be the first people to complain if the sound was an issue for us. People are always all dressed up and bring such an elegant feel to our neighborhood. It's a weekly occasion for us. We sit on our porch, we watch the people during the nice spring and summer months. I appreciate the owner and management for how considerate they've been to our neighborhood. It's obvious they go above and beyond. If you need any more information, please call me at my home or my cell. And she lists both her home and cell number. This is the person most directly affected. Again, if she could be here today, she would, and she was a very forceful presence down here when we were here basically 2 years ago. I would ask that the board approve this matter. We'll save whatever time for rebuttal that's left. Ed Clay, the client representative, is here. He'll make some comments, and others may make some few issues to the board, but we will save the remaining time for rebuttal.
Can I ask a question? So basically, your request is that we simply reapprove, and the only two changes would be 60 months and then the noise issue with the decibel of 70 decibels at the property line closest to the complaining person, right?
That's it. And I did want to reference, Mr. Chairman, that in part why these matters are almost always perfunctorily reapproved are because the board's looked at everything initially and they've said okay to it, and then the property owner spends some time and money in reliance. In this case, I don't ever think I've seen a case where the property owner spent this kind of time and money in reliance on it, has worked this hard with basically no complaint. And I will mention to you that probably, oh, 3 or 4 months ago, we had proposed a rule change to the board. And that was, if you have one of these special exceptions come up for which there hasn't been any significant objection, complaints, et cetera, they ought to be perfunctorily approved by the board. There's no reason for people to come down here, spend their money on lawyers, engineers, as the case may be, if in fact the board's already determined those matters initially, as they did 2 years ago. And in this specific case, the vote was 5-0 2 years ago, and three of the current members were of those present. There's one that's not here today, and we've got a new member of the board. But that was the vote, 5-0, and my comment is yes, there's only two items that were suggesting changes, 60 months and our proposed special condition that I've just mentioned. Thank you.
So my name is Ed Clay. I just want to go over some of the things that we've done. One, we've spent a little over $500,000 on the property, fixing it up. It's a historic home. Requires a tremendous amount of work constantly. And our staff does a really good job at that, keeping it very clean, keeping it all the repairs up to date. We've also given over $2,500 in donations to the school up the road, also made donations to the neighborhood for signs and things like that. I'm not sure if you have the brochures, but you can kind of see the property on the brochures. The types of events we do are mostly weddings. I would say 90% weddings. They're nice weddings, higher-end weddings. East Ivy is one of the nicer wedding venues in Nashville. We've really strived to actually keep the sound down in the neighborhood. I mean, we've had engineers out there. We've walked the property, walked it with decibel readings. The only time that I was aware of a police complaint, I was actually standing outside next to the valet. The police came up. I said, well, you're welcome to walk the property with me. They walked it, and there was no problem. As soon as I heard there were four complaints, I actually called Sergeant Fisher, who's our neighborhood liaison. I said, where are these four complaints? I didn't know about them. And he says, I don't see anything but that one, which it wasn't a problem. We had met in front of the neighborhood every 6 months like we're supposed to. They had thanked us every time for doing a good job with the parking, doing a good job with the sound, and for being a good neighbor. I wasn't aware that there was any problem until we reapplied for this, and that's where we're at now.
How many events did you hold? Are you holding the 125 per year that's authorized?
So last year, I'm going to guesstimate around 60. This year, between 85 and 100.
Do the guests have full use of the entire property?
Yes, they have full use of the entire property.
Okay.
Do we have any other questions? Okay, then the rest of your time is for rebuttal. And the opposition can come forward.
So, Michael, cue me.
Mr. Chairman, thank you, Jamie Holland, members of the board. I represent Wayne Goodwin, who lives at 514 Russell Street. The applicant, through his exceptional attorneys, has presented a great and appealing case. Too bad it ignores the applicable law in this instance, and maybe that's why. It ignores a state statute, ignores the applicable ordinance, and it ignores case law. In the end, this is not a matter of opinion, but a matter of law. Consequently, it's not even a close call. So if we drill down into 1716-160B2, we find something pretty clear. The events shall be within a historically significant structure as determined by the Historic Zoning Commission. Next slide, John Michael. So before we even go into that analysis, let's look at the state statute that gave the council the power to give the Board of Zoning Appeals the power to make special exception decisions. So that statute is 1372-06A. It's the enabling legislation that gives the power to the council, to this board, to make special exceptions. However, that power that the council gave is not absolute. 1372-06A, right here, the zoning ordinance, may provide that the Board of Appeals may, in appropriate cases and in subject to the principal standards, rules, conditions, and safeguards set forth in the zoning ordinance, make special exceptions to the terms of the zoning regulations in harmony with their general purpose and intent. So we go back to, if we go back two slides, John Michael, we're talking about where can we do it? Location, here we are, historically significant structure. Forward two more, John Michael, thank you. So we've got one more. So we've got three possible definitions in the zoning code of what is a historically significant structure. The thing is, excuse me, Tom, the thing about those three definitions is that there's a caveat to all of them, and it's as determined by the Historic Zoning Commission. In other words, the council said, hey, BZA, we don't want you to determine what the location of these events are. Instead, we're delegating that power to the Historic Zoning Commission. Well, what does the Metro Historic Zoning Commission say? Well, there's a letter dated January 15, 2016, from the Zoning Department, from the Historic Zoning Department to John Michael. And the last sentence is instructive. I hope that's in your packet. Other than the principal dwelling, there are no other historic subjects or objects on the site. So if we go back to the beginning, first line, the events shall be within a historically significant structure as determined by the Historic Zoning Commission. Now, if we want to do a case of statutory construction and what the word shall means, what the word within means, I think we'd all come to the conclusion, based on the plain and ordinary language used therein, that the word within means inside. So as a matter of law, this Board of Zoning Appeals cannot determine location. Instead, the power of the council in this instance was given to the Metro Historic Zoning Commission, and the BZA has no discretion to the contrary. Any and all events permitted by this BZA should be limited to the inside of the principal dwelling only. Absent such limitation, we seek a denial. But I would like to correct perhaps some misnomers. And there seems to be some undue reliance on the investment made by the applicant. It is clear in the code that a special exception is not an entitlement. And to the extent he made such an investment to his detriment, he's responsible for that detriment. The De Montbrin trilogy, or however many cases we've got in that regard, one thing is clear out of those cases. A prior complaint is not a basis to deny an application. Not a basis. So the absence of a complaint is therefore not a basis. Moreover, due to the nature of the events held by the applicant and the good nature of my client, I would hope the board would not consider the fact that he didn't call the police every time an event was had. Don't take it away from him for being a decent human and not want to interrupt someone's wedding. Absent any further questions, Mr. Chairman, I'll rest, and the balance of the time can be used for anyone else who here would like to speak.
I do actually have a question.
Yes, sir.
The Historic Commission on December 23rd sent an email that said, this property is a contributing property to the Edgefield National Register of Historic Places District and therefore meets the qualification of a historic home event that the building must be historic. In that one, she talks about the property.
I don't have that document, Mr. Chairman. I'd be happy to review it.
This one.
What's the date on
it? It's December 23rd,
2015. So what was your question, Mr. Chairman? I've now read it.
Well, I mean, you properly drew attention to the email of January 15 and the sentence that other than the principal dwelling, there's no historic structures or objects on the site. I was just noting that there's also an email that refers to the property meeting the qualification of a historic home event and that the building must be historic. And it says it, in other words, it draws no distinction between the house and the property.
Well, I would just say the latter in time and more specific would be control, and I think that's what a court would hold also.
Could be.
Yeah.
I have a question, Mr. Holland, and I appreciate your position that a complaint would not be a basis for a denial, but did your client complain at all to his neighbor? Did he keep a calendar? Is that what is his specific issue with regard to the, I'm going to speak directly to the noise.
If you would, can I invite him up here, ma'am?
Mm-hmm.
State your name. Hello, I'm Wayne Goodwin. I live at 514 Russell Street. I'm sorry, what was your question?
Noise and about the use of outside amplification.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And is your complaint based on future occurrence or have there been specific complaints for the last 26 months?
We have, well, a little background. My wife and I thoroughly enjoy our garden and sitting outside, and we've basically been denied in many cases that because of the excessive noise. Not all the time, but on occasion there have been situations where we can't sit in our backyard and have just a reasonable conversation, so we've moved inside. There have been other instances where, and these have been the ones where I've actually called the police, where we're sitting in our bedroom with the television on and can still hear the music being played, and that's really excessive. We weren't building a case. You know, we wanted to give this thing a chance to work, and because we don't have a problem with East Ivy being an historic home event venue. We would like them to conform to what the council intended in their ordinance, and that is to have the events inside the main house.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Any other opposition?
My name is Carol. My name is Carol Norton. I live on Boscoville Street, and I was here a little over 2 years ago to talk to y'all about this. And you and you and you, since you were here and voted, are part of the problem that arose with there being the decision to allow this property to be used as an historic event throughout the entire property and not inside the historic structure as defined by the ordinance. And as legal counsel for Mr. Goodwin has explained to you, the reason, to answer your question earlier about why there are two notices from the Historic Zoning Commission, 2 years ago, I lit into them for not having made the description specific then. This time, when I saw that they had done a similar thing, I lit into them. Others had concerns because this board allowed the historic home event venue to take place on the property and redefined what council and the ordinance had specified. So I'm hoping that you will rectify that. I have no problem with there being an historic home event venue at this location as long as you enact the same restrictions and require them to do the same thing that the Demumbrian House does. The events are inside. The Ambrose House, the events are inside. Those are the two urban historic home event venues I'm aware of. Others, Cedarwood, Riverwood, they're more than 5 acres. They can do all sorts of things. Why should these folks have to pitch four tents in their backyard? That's not appropriate. Have them inside. Have the events inside. There should be no music outside at all. There should be no events outside at all. I sent my letter of opposition last week, and I don't know if Mr. Herbert included it. It should have. If you need to visualize what...
We received it, ma'am. We have it in our packet.
It's in color. This is shows you what the historic structure is. And if you renew the permit for a historic home venue at this location, I am asking you to do it within the legal definition of what that is, which is inside the historic structure. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Logan Key, and I live at 1411 Fatherland Street, and am a former board member of the Historic Edgefield Neighborhood Association. I want to make remarks about a couple of different aspects of this case. I want to save my remarks about the the language of the ordinance for the end of my remarks. One point I want to make first, though, is I would submit to you that the council never intended for outdoor events to be permitted under this seldom utilized provision of the code, because what that would do would be utterly alter or distort or disrupt the broader residential context in the area. The council created this provision to let residential owners of historic homes hold events in their homes for a fee, charge a fee to do so, but in a way that would not disrupt and distort the broader residential landscape. And the way the council accomplished that was by very carefully crafting the language in the code, which says that events must take place within the historically significant structure. And so what that does is it eliminates any risk that the broader residential context will be impinged upon, and that neighbors would suddenly find themselves in the midst of some commercial use where otherwise they should have the privilege of residential use. The second point I want to make is that the Ambrose House, which is located 8 blocks from East Ivy, operates under a historic home event special exception, and it's situated adjacent to a very large vacant lot. So it would be very practical and very lucrative, probably, for the Ambrose owners to hold events on that adjacent property. Notably, though, this board specifically forbade the Ambrose owners from holding outdoor events. In fact, after their initial permit was granted, this board submitted a letter clarifying the nature of outdoor events, and in fact, the letter to the Ambrose owners said, and I'll submit this for the record if it would be helpful, attendees of events shall be permitted to exit the structure on occasion to stroll about the grounds, visit the garden, or catch a breath of fresh air. However, no part of the event shall be staged outside of the historic structure. I think if you look at Ambrose and look at East Ivy, you're looking at two very comparable properties to the extent that they're both in close proximity to residential, to other residences. You're looking at an urban neighborhood. You're looking at, in my opinion, an opportunity to treat like properties alike, to treat similarly situated properties in a similar fashion. And the fact of the matter is they're only 8 blocks from each other. The last point I want to make goes back to the issue of construction of the code. I think the most persuasive part of this case is the fact that the plain language of the code constrains not only what the applicant can do under the special exception use, but I would submit to you that it constrains you from what you can allow the applicant to do under the special exception. The code gives this board very broad discretion over the number of events, the number of attendees, the hours of operation, etc., etc., but it I would submit doesn't allow you to deviate from the inside of the structure, but the code is very clear in that respect. The fact that codes police have seldom, if ever, been called, that there were neighborhood negotiations, that the East Ivy controllers have made donations to the school, the decibel levels, those are all non-issues. Those are non-events. The fact is, the Historic Zoning Commission is on the record saying what part of the property is historically significant, and the code says events must take place within that space. And for that reason, I would hope that you will respect that and rule accordingly. Thank you.
Good afternoon, board members. My name is Brett Withers. I'm the Metro Council for District 6. My home address is 1113 Granada Avenue. I appreciate Mr. Clay and his willingness to work with our neighbors, as well as Mr. White and coming out and speaking with our neighbors. This is not a personality conflict in the sense that no one is saying that they're bad neighbors. That is not the nature of the complaint. The nature of the complaint that is compelling to me is that the ordinance does limit your ability to permit events to within historic structures. That ultimately for me is what is compelling evidence in reading the code that is based upon my conversations with some of the council members who drafted that legislation. And I know of even for other council members who have represented District 6 in the past, there's a letter that I believe is in your packet, and if it's not, I can submit it to the record from Councilmember Jeff Ackerman, who again reiterated that the Board of Zoning Appeals special exception permit only applies to events within the home. So to me, that's a very cut and dry issue. Mr. Ackerman's letter also points out that for outside amplified music, there are other types of permits that are available for that, but those would not be a historic home event. There is a small outdoor music event venue that was created by the Metro Council for commercial activities that want to have music outside. There are a number of other ways of dealing with that, but the historic home event special exception itself does not permit events outside the home. Now, does this mean that people cannot go outside of the home into the yard? No, it does not mean that. But clearly, I think the council anticipated that having outdoor events possibly with a noise component would be cumbersome to residential neighborhoods, and that is I think is reflected in past decisions that you
don't have a time limit.
Okay.
As a councilman, you don't have a time limit.
Sure, appreciate that. But again, some of the other neighbors have referenced similarly situated properties, in particular Ambrose House, which allows guests to utilize the property, but the event itself must not be scheduled outside. Of course, the De Munbrien House case is a very similar property, also situated in a residential neighborhood, and I believe that he's not allowed to have amplified music out of doors entirely, with the exception maybe of about 20 minutes or something like that. But clearly, even in most of your prior decisions for similarly situated properties, you have, I believe, respected the intent of the council in that ordinance that says, sure, people can go outside, but the event itself and amplified music related to those events should be contained to the indoor historic structure itself. So really that is the basis of my position, is just that I think the legislation says very clearly that events must be contained within the interior of the historic structure. Again, there are other permits that are available for those seeking to do outside events. If this particular applicant wishes to do that, he should move forward with one of those type of permits, but that's not what is before you today. One other thing I would like to point out with regard to the conditions that were approved last time, obviously last time the board did approve that amplified music would be permitted within certain hours. A statement was made by Mr. White, who I have a lot of respect for his opinion, but I would really appreciate clarification from perhaps Ms. Jones or from this board. But a statement was made that in terms of noise from any outdoor events, that the historic home event special exception exempts those properties and those users from the noise ordinance. And I would like to seek clarification about that. And one of the reasons in particular why I would like to seek clarification about that is because Special Condition 17 speaks to violations, but it states that if there are two or more violations within 30 days confirmed by any Metro Law or Courts Enforcement Officer regarding a violation of Metro noise ordinances, this matter will be returned to the Board of Zoning Appeals for a show cause hearing. That suggests to me that, in fact, events that might take place outside would be subject to the regular noise ordinance is the way that I'm reading that, but I would appreciate clarification on that. So certainly for me, I think legislatively the clear intent of the council was to have events indoors. Whatever continues to transpire at this property, I think both sides need clarification about what a violation is and how that should be enforced. And so I just submit that feedback to the body and would appreciate your consideration of the original intent of the council's legislation. Thank you.
Just one moment, please. Mr. Chairman, in rebuttal, I'll make these comments. First, the issues that were raised today about within an historic structure are the exact issues that were raised before this board 24 months ago. Exactly. The board made a decision that we were correct. At that time, there may have been conflicting opinions from the Historic Commission, just like there are today. But as the chairman read, there's one absolute clear letter that says it applies to the property itself. That's exactly what our argument was 2 years ago. That's exactly what this board accepted 2 years ago. Nothing has changed there. So that matter, as far as I'm concerned, as a matter of law, is res judicata. It's decided. And as I said, we came into this room 24 months ago and announced a resolution on all these issues other than amplified music. That issue was resolved by the board favorably to us. We don't go back and revisit that. The other, and that's specifically spelled out in that letter referenced by the chairman of December 23, 2015, which is a very short time ago, that makes no difference between the structure and the premises. Now, I want to comment as well that after the hearing 24 months ago, a lawsuit was filed by Jamie Holland. In that lawsuit, he questioned this very issue. He never followed up on the lawsuit. It's still sitting there in the Sixth Circuit Court in Davidson County. If there was some merit to that, it should have been pursued. But the very issue he's raising here, he raised in this lawsuit. Again, it's sitting there dormant, period, which gives you some idea of the merit they think there might be there. With respect to the noise, let's be realistic about this. If it's inside the structure, outside the structure, isn't the issue, is it offending somebody? Isn't that the real issue? It's not form over substance here. Think about this for a minute. You can keep it inside. You could blast a band inside, open up the windows. Wouldn't that be a whole lot more offensive to neighbors than talking about inside versus outside? I mean, the question is whether it's in or it's out, what's the net effect? And I said to this board as I started, there was one individual who made a complaint about the noise. It's the one same individual who was here 24 months ago. He's here again today. I'm not disparaging his right to come down here and be heard before this group, but it's an individual that admitted he'd never called Mr. Ed Clay. He sat there at a neighborhood meeting less than a month ago where the other people in the group who were seven in number said, gosh, when we've called Mr. Clay, he responded immediately. He took care of issues. None of them were noise, but they were other issues that they had concerns with. So the contact in good faith never went to Mr. Clay. And despite that, we've given a proposal here of a condition that I remind you, the board of Historic Edgefield clearly endorsed and said, we support the proposal. It may not be the couple of the individuals that came here, but the board, through their chair, authorized it, signed off on it. The councilman received that, as did we, for 60 months with the condition we're now enumerating. It's a very simple measure. Why call the police? Let them take an hour or two to get there. Mr. Clay's on the property. Call him. He's there with a decibel reader. You go right to the complaining property line and you do a reading. Take a picture of it. That's simple. It's over. If there's more than two violations in 30 days, it comes back to the board for show cause. So we would urge you, the special exception for historic homes can't be any more better defined than this specific piece of property. It's been there since the Civil War. There's all kinds of history there. It's very appropriate. We've got a 12-foot wall around the property, which you've seen in these pictures. So it's not an open field. And you've heard the issue from the lady that lives directly across the street with the music directed to her, who said it's an asset to the community and they enjoy it. But if you're talking about not tearing down and basically destroying old houses and making them special events, you couldn't have any more of a quintessence of a good example than this property that the client has spent $500,000 plus fixing up. That's what this whole ordinance was proposed for in the first place. We'd urge you to approve it for the 5 years with the special condition which we'd offered. If the other side feels like there's a legitimate legal issue, they can file or refile a lawsuit, which they didn't follow up on last time. Thank you for your courtesy. We'll answer any questions.
Questions? Christine. Okay, thank you very much. Move to close the public hearing and to start discussion.
Maybe we could have a discussion about whether or not, in fact, the determination is res judicata. I tend to think that it would be, given that's a determination previously made by the board that stands unless it's appealed, unless I'm mistaken on that.
Um, I would disagree. I think each case that comes before the board has to stand on its own merits based on that application at that time. At the time that the board issued that opinion or issued that order, it had a time limit on it, as I understand it, and that's why it is back before the board at this point. So I don't think that you can rely on the evidence that was presented at the board at that time for that decision to substantiate this board's decision today. I think you have to look at the evidence that's before the board as of today.
But, okay, and I'm not disagreeing. I'm just following Cindy's point. I think Cindy's point is that we as a quasi-judicial board made a legal decision at that time that the word within was not an imperative that we had to follow, rather it was the property itself that was historic. I mean, much like the email from the Historic Commission says, the property contributes, therefore it meets the definition of historic home event. I would also note, because this really didn't get brought up very much, but the reason for this special exception is because if you go back 10 years ago, these houses were getting torn down because nobody would take them on and fund them because they were just too expensive. And so this was a commercial way of saving the properties. But I bring that up only because I was around during the period when they were getting bulldozed. So anyway, I'm sorry. Those are my only thoughts.
I'm not actually sure what to say, but as someone who wasn't on the board then, I guess I should say something. But I guess I just see the case as it is today because I wasn't on the board. So I do feel that I guess I would really listen to what the council person says, since there's compelling arguments on either side, and the council person is a mediator. And I think I would limit the amount of music on the site, maybe limit the hours more, or eliminate it altogether just based on what we've heard. But I'm not really sure how we determine that.
I really have mixed emotions about the site. It's an incredible building. Also sympathize with the neighbors. They put up with the Titan games, as do the fans, hardly. I think there's got to be a resolve here for this thing, actually. There's obviously a resolve. I can't condone loud music. I'd be hard-pressed to push for making it only indoors. I'd do some thinking on this one.
Well, actually, that kind of gets to my point. The difficulty is when there are only four of us, we have to be unanimous. And at this point, as I count noses, I don't see unanimous. And so I wonder if there is some wisdom in giving them two more weeks to discuss it with the council person. See, because they worked it out last time. Is there a way to have a resolution between the parties, and in the meantime, the other three might get to hear it? Because if we vote here and it's less than four on either side, now we're just making them watch the TV version of this as opposed to hearing it. So would it be appealing to anybody? I mean, I don't like to hear cases twice either, but that makes more sense to me than having 2-2 or 3-1 and asking our three friends to watch on TV.
I agree. I think it's too important to make it a very close call. And I move we defer it for
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
I think I may note that their permit runs out in a couple of weeks too, and so it's probably best to bring it back in 2 weeks. So Dick, do you want to make that motion?
I move that we defer it 2 weeks.
I'd second. Got a motion, got a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes.
The matter will be heard at the next Board of Zoning Appeals meeting on February the 4th, 2016, 1 p.m. in this same location. That concludes the business of the Board of Zoning Appeals for today.